so far away. Oh, we traveled in light today, in the eye of the storm, the eye of the storm. Oh, to a new and shiny place, make our pity but say our grace. Freedom's like burning warm, freedom's like burning warm.
George Washington knew when he asked Betsy Ross to design our flag that the young nation needed a symbol of freedom. And what they needed was something that would suggest the strong struggle necessary to obtain it.
Throughout our history, it has flown in glory over valiant troops from the Revolution all the way to Iwo Jima.
Today, whenever the American flag flies, it remains a constant reminder to all Americans and to the rest of the world what it means to be free.
And although there may be a few who don't agree, we still believe Old Glory deserves a place of honor and respect.
Hey!
for standing. Now, if you will, recite with me the Pledge of Allegiance, and please remain standing as we sing our national anthem. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Blessed our country with an array of colorful landscapes and breathtaking shorelines.
From the deserts to the Great Lakes, from Niagara Falls to the Grand Canyon.
Everywhere you look, you can see God's creative handiwork.
The most beautiful land in all the world.
Thank you.
Well, singing about those amber waves of grain and the fruited plains reminds me that you can't pay tribute to America and its people without mentioning those who have made America the number one food-producing nation in the world. And I'm talking about the farmers of America. So we're going to invite you to join with us and sing Old MacDonald. I want to be reminded of that. This is one of my favorite songs I learned when I was Curtis Elkins' age about 60 years ago. And it's a wonderful song. Curtis, you're over 60, right? Okay, I hope so. But we've got some elements to help us here. We've got some chickens and ducks and dogs and pigs and turkeys and even a banjo player. Oh, the rest of the animals are in the barn. We're trying to get them back in the barn. Here they come. They got loose there for a second, so. But I want y'all to join with us. We're going to have a good time singing this to remind ourselves of what makes America great. It's diversity. Give our little farm hands a round of applause. Thank you, guys.
If tomorrow all the things were gone I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my family and my wife. I thank the Lord above that I'm living here today, for the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA. Well, there's pride in every American's heart, and it's time to stand and say,
I want to take time in our program now to introduce to you a very special group of people. You know, all of us have the freedom to be able to come and enjoy this program today without fear of persecution or intrusion from an outside enemy.
We're able to do that today because thousands of men and women throughout our history have defended our freedom by serving as members of the armed forces. Many of our friends paid the ultimate sacrifice defending our land, and today we want to proudly pay tribute to those who have served us all so faithfully.
In a moment, we will be singing the hymns from the major four groups of our armed services: the Army, the Air Force, the Navy, and the Marines. If you have served in any of these branches of the service, we would like to acknowledge that by you standing when your song is sung, that we might give appreciation to you for a job well done.
Step in time. serve their land.
These are the ones who serve their land.
All for the army, give a hand.
All for the army, give a hand. Over hill, over dale, we have hit the dusty trail, and those caissons go rolling above. In and out,
hear them shout,
counters marching by the fountain.
Please remain standing just for a moment. We want to give you another hand as everyone who served in the armed forces in the building. Thank you so much. God bless you for your sacrifice. You may be seated.
Bravo, bravo. Oh, how you doing? I'm just looking around.
Things sure have changed since I've been here. Cars, people, houses, everything just seems different. Oh, let me introduce myself. My name is Sergeant Tom Edwards of the 77th Division. I'm not even sure if that division still exists anymore. During the war, World War II that is, mine was the best fighting battalion in the whole South Pacific. I guess they're not there anymore. You see, I'm not sure what's there anymore because I never came back from the war. I was killed on the island in Nakashita while evacuating some orphan children. I got hit while running with two children under my arms. They made it okay, but I wasn't that lucky. But you see, I'm not complaining because I knew when I signed up what I was in for. And you know what? I wasn't the only one that took a hit that day. In fact, there have been countless thousands of Americans who have risked their lives so that those at home can enjoy freedom. So why am I back? I came to see exactly what kind of shape this country is in. It's good to see that freedom is still the basis for America. While I still see the Statue of Liberty is standing tall, it makes me so proud. Same is true when I see our flags waving overhead. You see that good-looking boy right over there? That's my son. The hardest thing about giving my life for this country was not being able to spend time with him. I was killed when he was just 3 years old, and I feel like I missed so much. Let's listen in to them, and don't worry, they can't hear us or see us.
Papa, what are you thinking?
Well, I was just thinking about my dad. I wish I could have known him better, had a chance to love him. You see, he was killed 56 years ago today.
Grandpa, what was he like?
Well, I don't really remember much, most of what your great-grandmother has told me. But I know this. He loved me and your great-grandmother very much, and he would have been so proud of all of you.
Was he a hero?
He sure was. He paid the ultimate price. You see, he was rescuing kids, not much younger than yourselves, from being from bombs that were being dropped during their orphanage. He gave his life helping others so that they too could grow up and enjoy being free.
I never really thought about it that way. It must have been really hard for you growing up without him.
Yes, it was. There were so many times I just wanted to see him, just to look at him or talk to him, even if only for a minute. There's a letter that I've read every year on this day for as long as I can remember. When your grandfather's body was found, this was in his shirt pocket. He had written it to me that morning. Your great-grandmother gave it to me on my 18th birthday. And I think it's time you heard what it had to say. It was written July 1st, 1945. He said, "Dear son, I know you're too young to read yet, but I've been thinking so much about you these past few days. I just had to write and let you know how much I love you. I hate like crazy being away from you and your mother. I just hope this war gets over soon so we can be together as a family. Every day I realize the reason I'm here fighting is so you and thousands of little boys and girls will be able to grow up in a free country. But freedom isn't free. In fact, we all have to do whatever it takes in order to guarantee that we will never lose the freedom that so many have given their lives to protect. That's why I'm here doing my part, and that's why our country is so great. It's the one common bond all Americans share. Though I don't enjoy being away from you, I'm proud to be defending our country. I hope one day when you're old enough to understand, you'll be proud of me too. Well, I have to go for now. There are some boys and girls on this island who don't have any parents, and I've got to get them out before they get hurt. So even though you can't read yet, I always want you to know how much I love you. Take good care of your mother and give her a real big hug for me. And son, don't grow up too fast without me. Love. My dad's dream has come true. And I'm proud of him. His love and sacrificed for our country live on in my heart today. And I want them to live on in your hearts too, in your children's. If it was worth great-grandfather's dying for, it's worth our living for. Dad, if you can hear me, I love you.
I love you too, son. Well, I gotta go. But you know, what my son said is true. If God gave us this great land and so many people in America's history have died to set it free, then we, as a generation, need to make sure that the next 200 years are free. So I'm counting on you. Don't let us down.
Now, as Americans, we enjoy freedom and liberty that millions of people around the globe don't get to enjoy. And we as Christians, I know that it is our desire for God to bless America. It's my desire. I want to see our country flourish. I want to see it prosper. And I want God's blessings upon our country, the United States of America. But you know, there's some things that's going to have to take place. Our country is in need of a revival. It's in need of people, the people of God, taking a stand for the things of God and living for God. Solomon, when he was reigning over Israel, and there was a time where the Lord came and spoke to Solomon, and he told him that he was going to make his place there. And that in the difficult times when things weren't going right, when God would cause no rain to fall upon the land, when the land would be desolate, he told Solomon these words because he heard Solomon's prayer. He said, Solomon, trouble comes. Here's how things will get turned around. And it's found in 2 Chronicles 7:14 where he said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. America, revival won't come to America through the courthouse. It's not going to come to America through the state house. It's only going to come through the church house. When God's people humble themselves and pray and seek God's face and get this, turn from their wicked way. Let me tell you why revival hasn't come. It's because God's people had turned from their wicked ways. Because he said, at that point, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sins and will heal their land. You know, God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he told Solomon, Solomon, this is the recipe to bring healing to the land. If you want revival, if you want the things to turn around, here's how what it takes. It takes my people, God's people. He identifies who it takes. That's you and me. To humble ourselves and pray and turn. Repent is what that means. Turn from. Make an about face from our wicked ways. And God said, then will I hear from heaven and forgive your sins and heal your land. I want God to bless America. I want God to stir the hearts of his people. And I want us as the people of God to seek God, to humble ourselves before God, to repent of our sins and to call upon God and then go out as a mighty army and share what true freedom is. And that's knowing Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord. With heads bowed and eyes closed. Do you know Christ as your personal Savior this morning? Has there ever been a time in your life where you called upon God to forgive you of your sins and to come into your heart and to be your Savior? If you can't remember a time when you've done that, we invite you to come this morning. Allow us to show you from God's Word how you can become a follower of Christ today and have a loving relationship with God's only begotten Son. People of God, I challenge you to do as the psalmist David did and say, search me, O God, and know my heart. Know my thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me. And as the Lord deals with your heart, you turn from those ways. You seek him. Father, Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for the freedom that we enjoy as Americans. Lord, but more importantly, we thank you for the freedom as believers in Jesus Christ that we enjoy in him. Father, if there's one here this morning that does not know Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, they've never called upon you to come into their heart, repented of their sin, Father, I pray that today, this will be the day when they'll call upon Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, I pray that you'll convict the hearts of your people. I pray, Lord, that you'll send revival, Lord, and let it begin with me. May that be each of our prayers. Let it begin with me. Lord, may your will be done and accomplished in each and every life. And we'll give you the praise, the honor, and glory for what you do. As we prayerfully stand, quietly and prayerfully, and begin to sing a verse of invitation, time where you can make a decision for Jesus Christ, you come as the Lord leads you.
Just as I am without.
Too, there was a song that served as the battle cry, just as there has been in every war that we've participated in as Americans. And in World War II, the song that served as our battle cry was God Bless America. Sit and enjoy as Larry sings the first verse of God Bless America, and then he's going to sing through the chorus. For anyone who doesn't already know the words, feel free to join. But the second chorus, we'll all stand and sing when he comes back to the second chorus.